a use of equipment after calibration, the next major concept is maintenance. This is also called MQ or maintenance qualification. So what is MQ? MQ is a broad term used in the process used to describe and document the regular maintenance and repair of the equipment. It ensures that the equipment is operated to give accurate results and to avoid downtime. Every MQ starts with a maintenance plan. A maintenance plan should include preventive maintenance procedures, inventory management, troubleshooting, and repair of the equipment. When I say inventory management, it's mostly about the spare parts inventory that we are talking about. For each piece of equipment, establish a routine maintenance plan to include the frequency of all maintenance tasks, daily, weekly, and monthly, 3 monthly as needed, etc. Training should be given for all authorized maintenance steps. Never attempt unauthorized maintenance steps. These are all key concepts, and this part should be a part of the training generally given to the technicians as an equipment is installed and it is part of the OQ or the operational qualifications. However, to keep it going is entirely the responsibility of the laboratory. Depending upon factors such as workload, types of instrumentation and number of employees, a record or a check sheet of such activities must be adopted for any given equipment in the laboratory. And it's important that the laboratory management tracks these tasks just to make sure that things are getting done. The documentation of maintenance is a very, very important aspect. And that's what we were talking about. And hope that is clear now. So maintenance qualification starts with the maintenance plan. And that maintenance plan has to be developed as the equipment arrives in the laboratory. And this has to be developed as part of the OQ. And it has to be carried out, implemented. Just establishing it is not enough. It has to be implemented. And it has to be documented in the specific formats designed for the purpose. So we just will show you a few formats or maintenance logs for a few different equipment here. Such formats have to be developed for all equipment used in the laboratory. This is a format for the daily maintenance of a particular equipment. There are about 30 days which are depicted. Since it is a daily event, there are 31 entries. Each activity has to be done on a daily basis. The first one says execute shutdown. The next says check the trap chamber and so on. So all these things will be done, and after the technician does it, it has to be checked off with a check mark. And it has to be signed. So that's how you evidence that you have done your daily maintenance. I hope that is clear. Again, weekly maintenance, there are 4 weeks in a month, maybe 5 Mondays. So every Monday to every Monday, there are certain tasks to be done, which will be done and checked off. Then following that, there will be monthly maintenance schedules and everything should be documented. And here there's another example of an equipment cleaning and decontamination format. Please look at the components of it. There's a sample autoclave format for a biosafety cabinet operation format, pre-operational checklist, sampled equipment training log, etc. Training logs are also very important. And so every aspect of the equipment management has to be logged, formatted, and everything should be recorded. So this is a very important aspect of documentation of your equipment, that of your maintenance plan, that every maintenance aspect. So now you have to now look at the documentation once again. You have started your documentation at the very beginning and you're carrying it on through every step. Now that we are in maintenance, we are talking about formats for maintenance at every kind of maintenance, including the training in equipment maintenance. So now we'll go a little more into the maintenance plan. We already talked about the formatting activities, and maintenance plan should also include function checks, which include monitoring of instrument parameters periodically, daily, weekly, and monthly. Some of the function checks have been shown in this picture, like incubation temperature, wavelength calibration, autoclave temperature chart. All these are function checks. So this also should be monitored and documented as required. And the third part of your maintenance plan should be your spare parts inventory. We already talked about it. This should include the routine maintenance of spare parts in the training. This in to understand what parts can be replaced and how. The technician should know that an inventory should be maintained for this. We have talked about this in the first video also. Spare part inventorization, understanding how to change parts which are authorized. This is a very helpful thing. Staff should be trained, and this will considerably reduce downtime if your laboratory staff are adequately trained on doing this. And now that we have a plan for maintenance, you have to now implement the plan. This is again a very important step. Not making the plan is not just enough. The implementation should be done. So establishing a plan is the first part, and implementing it is the next and the key step for the maintenance qualification, for which you have to assign responsibilities and develop written policies and procedures. You have to maintain records and training of staff, of course. All of them are very, very key aspects of your implementation of your maintenance plan. Assigning responsibility. Generally, it is assumed that the frontline staff responsibility is for the person who is authorized to do the work, the equipment, or his deputy. But periodic checking should be done by the quality manager or whoever has a higher authority. There should be written policies and procedures about who is going to do what and up to what level, and how do you escalate a process if there is a breakdown. All these should be clearly mentioned in your procedure. Records, as I said, should be maintained for everything that is done, and staff should train to maintain records also. So training of the staff is coming back again and again as a key concept. I have already talked about schedule of your maintenance, especially with reference to your authorized maintenance. We should also know about maintenance that is done by the technical support team. Let's call this scheduled maintenance, or sometimes it's also called preventive maintenance by the technical support team. So how is that different from what you are doing in the laboratory? So let's say that in addition to the daily maintenance, such schedule should be available for inspections and repair by the manufacturer's technical support team. This preventive maintenance is defined as a plan of scheduled inspections of equipment and instruments, resulting in minor adjustments or repairs for the purpose of delaying and avoiding major repairs and emergency or premature replacements. This kind of preventive maintenance is a very useful part of your equipment management and should be made available for all your equipment. If the laboratory has an annual or a comprehensive maintenance contract with the equipment manufacturer or with third parties, or if the equipment is under warranty, this becomes very easy to avail. And please see this diagram here. On the y-axis is the cost, and on the x-axis there are three components: reactive maintenance, preventive maintenance, and predictive maintenance. In the case of reactive maintenance, you will wait for the equipment to break down, as you're not availing any AMC or CMC, and then the repair cost, as you see, is very high. If you're looking at the predictive maintenance, you're replacing parts regardless of whether it has to be done or not at a certain time period, and that again becomes very high cost intensive. But if you look at the middle, there are these cost lines which are crossing each other. So that means this is the best option. The preventive maintenance is your best option to cut cost and to as well as prolong life of the equipment. I hope that concept is clear. So routine service and maintenance should be scheduled at regular predefined intervals so as to ensure uninterrupted workflow. This is assuming that you have a valid contract with your equipment manufacturer or a third party. The laboratory must have a documented process and maintain logs for preventive maintenance. Very important again, documentation. The schedule for equipment maintenance and calibration need to be prepared in advance as per the manufacturer's instructions and circulated among all laboratory staff so that the same can be rigorously adhered to. Preventive maintenance provides the following advantages over breakdown maintenance. We already saw the diagram, just to reiterate. Because it helps in giving you quality assured results, reduced breakdown and hence higher productivity, timely identification and replacement of components showing excessive wear and tear. So while they examine, they see something is not correct and something is getting worn out, the technical support team will change those parts. It's not a predictive maintenance, it's actually a preventive maintenance. So this certains greater safety, lowers repair costs, and it prolongs the instrument lifetime, and it also reduces your downtime. So now we have to move on to your next concept. And before that, we would like to just recap about the maintenance part. We have talked about maintenance. We have talked about two kinds of maintenance here. One is a maintenance by authorized. You doing the authorized maintenance steps by the laboratory staff in a scheduled way, daily, weekly, monthly, or as required. And there are other maintenance steps which are not authorized to the laboratory. So let's call them unauthorized maintenance steps. This can be done only by the technical support team. So that those have to be scheduled in a certain way as per the recommendation of the manufacturer itself. Okay, I hope that is clear. Authorized steps done by the laboratory as per the schedule of the manufacturer, again as per the requirement of that machine and how much it is used and depending on that. And other preventive scheduled maintenance which is done by the technical support team. For those steps which require certain inputs from the technical support team, because there are certain parts which will not be accessible. For those, you will have to call the step technical support team to come in and so that they can do the preventive maintenance on this scheduled basis. This is like generally maybe a 3-monthly, some equipment may have 6-monthly. So you have to look at the manufacturer's instructions. And while you are making your MQ, both these are important. Authorized maintenance step by your frontline staff and unauthorized maintenance steps by your technical support team in a scheduled manner. So that is your MQ. And after MQ, we come to another vital concept, which is also part of your routine maintenance, which is equipment safety. This is an ongoing process to ensure that the safety of the equipment and the personnel is maintained and all electrical and mechanical safety features are regularly checked and maintained. There are multiple concepts apart from electrical and mechanical safety, but they are primary issues here, and other concepts also will briefly give an overview. First, we'll go to the electrical safety. All equipment, wiring and cords must be maintained and used in a manner that keeps electrical insulations intact. Electrical appliances and equipment are protected from overloading by means of fuses or circuit breakers should be ensured. Grounding of electrical equipment should be checked regularly as it provides some protection to equipment operators. If there is a fault in the equipment or insulation that energizes the equipment housing, the electricity would flow into the ground rather than to the worker. This is the importance of grounding of an equipment. Electrical shocks can be avoided by ensuring that the equipment and electrical cords and plugs are in good repair. Grounded outlets are used and ground fault circuit interrupters or circuit breakers are used. Check that there is no overload of electrical circuit. Minimize and eliminate the use of multi-outlet power strips. This is an important concept. The extension cord can actually result in some kind of overloading, so this has to be used with caution. Since electrical devices can generate sparks, ensure that they are not used near flammable or volatile gases or liquids. That many points to consider regarding equipment and electricity. There are so many other points. This is some, in brief, something that you need to be aware of at the very outset. Now, regarding equipment and mechanical safety. After electrical safety, we need to think about mechanical safety also. This is also a very important concept, especially in certain equipment. So let's discuss a few examples of mechanical safety. It's not possible to discuss all examples. So we will just limit ourselves to a few key equipment. Equipment designed that include advanced safety features such as audible or visible signals. We already talked about this when we were talking about purchasing considerations. And availability of interlock or key lock systems and permanent shieldings, etc. should be considered whenever possible. An interlock system is a feature that makes the state of two mechanisms or functions mutually dependent. It's used to ensure occupational safety in mechanical devices and systems. This is a very important concept because if a certain part is moving, that part will not move if that equipment is open. There will be a door which will be connected to that moving part. So if the door is open, it will not actually move. But then people do some self-defeating steps like jamming the door or keeping it semi-open. And that is a very self-defeating thing to do. And such things should not be done because these are all made for the protection of the worker. So please check that during this kind of option, during the purchase part itself. And as I said earlier, never resort to self-defeating steps like opening equipment while it is working. In some old model centrifuges where interlocks are not available, it should always be borne in mind that careless handling of equipment can cause great hazards. Sometimes it's seen as a practice also that even before the centrifuge stops, the lid is opened. It's a very risky practice because of two things. One is aerosolization, because it's a biohazard. Most of your samples will have some pathogens that can be airborne. That's your very hazardous thing to do. And also, sometimes the chest tubes break and fragments of glass can just fly out and can injure you. So there are so many hazards because of opening a centrifuge while it is working. And another very hazardous equipment as far as physical safety is concerned is microtomes. Some of you may be using microtomes, so just a few precautions. Do not handle the blade with unprotected hands. Microtome with non-disposable knife should have a safety shield. It's a very extremely important step. Make sure to use forceps and wear gloves. Do not leave the blade exposed during sample loading on and unloading. Always remember to cover the blade. Cover the blade by using provided finger guards or protective foam guard over the blade during mounting and removal of the sample. Use forceps to remove the blade and wear two layers of nitrile gloves to help protect your fingers as far as possible. You do that. Final big warning is do not skip personal protective equipment while using microtomes. This will prevent lacerations and cuts. So now we talked about two kinds of safety where equipment is concerned, electrical and mechanical. Let's go to the third, which is biohazard and biosafety. Every effort should be made to prevent equipment from becoming contaminated and to reduce the likelihood of equipment malfunction that could result in leakage, spill, or unnecessary generation of aerosolized pathogens. Ensure that the service of equipment gets done according to the manufacturer's instructions. Ensure that anyone who uses a specific equipment or a piece of equipment is properly trained in setting it up, using it, and cleaning. Decontamination is a big word. This is a process, a very, very important process for removing or killing microorganisms. It is also used for removing or neutralizing hazardous chemicals and radioactive materials. All equipment should have a laid down protocol for decontamination. It is carried out on a daily basis after the work of the day is over. It's also done on as required basis, especially after spills. So which equipment need decontamination? Every equipment requires decontamination. Your fridges, your centrifuges, pipettes, biosafety cabinets, all laboratory equipment requires decontamination processes. And apart from equipment, you also need to clean other areas. We are talking about equipment here, but we also need to be aware that decontamination processes involves lab bench tops, sample collection areas, effluents, contaminated solid waste, etc. So decontamination practices should be part of your laboratory safety protocol, not just in equipment, but also in other areas. From decontamination, we move on to biomedical waste disposal. Most equipment will generate liquid, both reagent waste, byproducts, waste from laboratory, from the samples. All these will become part of your equipment effluent. Effluent is a major concern for laboratories. When placing an equipment in the laboratory, it should be made sure how to consider liquid waste will be handled. To be aware of this and comply with local and national requirements for liquid waste disposal in order to prevent contamination of the community sewage systems with pathogens and toxic chemicals. So that's the next step. Effluent management of liquid effluents is also a very important thing that we have to think through while we are operating our equipment in the lab. Now that we have talked about few aspects of equipment safety, there are other aspects that we have not included in this discussion, but you can read more about it in the equipment management module and in the facility safety and management modules, which are also on this website. All these will include ultraviolet safety, laser safety, glassware safety. These are all considerations of equipment safety, and this also should be thoroughly understood. Please read those modules which are available on this website. So we are done with now maintenance. So we have come to the next concept, which is indirectly part of your maintenance, but also a totally different aspect of it, which is backup equipment or backup referral labs in the case of breakdown. In certain circumstances, example, an analyzer repair or breakdown, lack of available consumables, lack of required reagents, control materials, continued failure in ECOWAS, etc., a laboratory may need to use backup equipment or backup laboratory for testing and reporting. The lab must develop a policy for use of backup instruments or laboratories in case of failure of testing equipment for all analytes being tested in the laboratory. So you should have a backup plan. There can be breakdown. So what is your backup plan? To ensure that the quality of the result or data produced using the backup equipment, the primary laboratory must be able to demonstrate acceptable testing proficiency and comparability between the primary and the backup equipment or the backup laboratories for such relevant analytes using tools such as laboratory audit reports, ECOA history, instrument validation, reference ranges, etc. So what does that mean? What do you mean by comparability between two equipment or two laboratories? Let me just explain this so that it become actually a practical thing rather than a theory thing. If two laboratories have different reference ranges because they are using, you assume that two laboratories have the reference ranges because they are using two different methods for testing an analyte, and the comparability can be compromised. And the patient and the clinicians may get confused with the results. Let's say one lab has a reference range for an analyte between 100 and 120, whatever units, and another lab has a reference range, which is a normal range again, between 120 and 140. And you are getting a report of 125, which is normal in the case of the latter lab, but is high in the case of the former lab. Such reports are confusing, and therefore comparability should be checked out before deciding upon outsourcing of the test or doing the test on a backup equipment. This is an important concept that has to be kept in mind. So even if you have more than one equipment in the laboratory which is routinely used, not even as a backup, but also you have two equipment and you're doing it alternatively, so there is no continuity for a patient who's coming. If the reporting ranges are different, you have to be mindful of that. This has to be borne in mind that methods can be different, and therefore biological reference ranges can be different, and these can create confusion for the clinicians and the patients. So comparability is a very important concept when you are thinking about any kind of equipment backup or even using two different equipment in a laboratory. Having said that, it's extremely vital thing that backup options are available either as equipment or as outsourced laboratories, which can be availed if there is an equipment breakdown, any other reason why tests cannot be undertaken after a patient sample has been accepted. So that is about having an equipment backup. You need to have an option, and that option should be the right option. The results should be comparable. You should also make sure that the backup equipment or the backup laboratory are doing well, if quality wise, and their results are comparable to yours, so that the patient and the clinician are not confused by your not doing the test on your routine equipment. So now that we talked about equipment backup, the next concept that we have to talk about is your power backup. All of us in India are frequently confronted with power outages. So critical equipment must be supported with uninterrupted power supply, or what we call UPS systems, to prevent damage to the equipment and to ensure continuity of the services. Selection of a proper size and type of UPS is very important, based on the lab's power source and voltage regulation. Size of UPS will depend upon the amount of power drawn by each subsystem and the battery backup time required. Two important considerations: the amount of power drawn by each system, each equipment, air conditioners, whichever you are using, and the battery backup time required. Ideal is an online UPS system. You have to read more about online UPS systems to understand the concepts well. But in short, this is a system which is hooked on to your online systems. And because the power is coming through this online system, even when there is a sudden power outage, you don't need to switch on anything because it's an automatic thing. And your entire laboratory will continue to function for a certain amount of time, depending upon the hours of backup which is available. Generally, the medium-sized UPS, online UPS systems, will give you 4 hours or at least 2 hours of backup, depending upon how much equipment or how much of electricity will be required for your lab for that period of time. And if you have an online UPS system, it will regulate the output voltage and has a smooth transition from mains to battery during an outage. This is something that every lab must give consideration to on having an online UPS system. It's also important to have laid down protocols for regular checks and maintenance of batteries of the UPS and change them based upon the backup support time. If you have an online UPS system or any kind of UPS system, it's not just enough to have it, but also the same kind of maintenance plan should be available for the UPS. Entire thing should be documented. Like any other equipment, UPS also deserves the same kind of treatment as your equipment management. And if the online UPS system is connected to a local power generator, especially if it has an automatic changeover system, this will ensure that your operations will not get interrupted till your supply is resumed. Such a backup system will ensure smooth equipment operation if there is prolonged power outages. This also may be a requirement in case of some of the labs, especially in remote areas with a lot of power outages. Please understand more on this through your electrical support unit in your laboratory, in your hospital, and this is something that you may want to discuss with your administration also. To have two kinds of electrical backup that we are talking about, one is a UPS, preferably an online system, and also a generator which is connected to the UPS so that the electricity will continue as far as possible and your services will not be interrupted. So after electricity, there's another utility very important in the laboratory, that is your analysis water. Many analyte testing, the water quality needs to be maintained. Generally, it is type 2 water which is required. Monitoring of water quality in terms of conductivity, resistivity, pH and TDS or total dissolved solids are required to maintain quality of reports for many biochemical analytes. For more on this, you may please refer to the equipment management module of Labs for Life. In this video, we talked about the maintenance plan. Basically, we are now in the using an equipment under which initially in the earlier video we talked about calibration. In this video, we talked about the maintenance plan. We talked about making a maintenance plan and implementing a plan and documenting that plan. And when we talked about, then we talked about safety. We talked about certain aspects of safety, electrical safety, physical safety, and biosafety. And then we moved on to the concept of having backup equipment. Backup equipment is required in case of equipment breakdown. How do you have the continuity of services? Therefore, you need a backup equipment. And later on, we talked about power backup, which is again something to ensure continuity of services. If there is a power outage, how do you continue carry on your work? So that is your power backup. And we finally talked about water quality as an important part of the utilities that you need in your laboratory. These are all concepts which are included in the equipment management, though they are smaller concepts. These are very vital concepts and should be paid enough attention to ensure for the smooth operation of your equipment.